बिस्मिल्लाहिर्रहमानिर्रहीम, अस्सलाम वालेकुम। वेलकम बैक टू योर ऑनलाइन लेक्चर सीरीज ऑफ EEEE2 माइक्रो प्रोसेसर सिस्टम्स। दिस इज एन एक्सक्लूसिव लेक्चर रिलेटेड टू योर सिक्स लैब्स दैट वर रिमेनिंग आफ्टर द मिड टर्म एग्जाम्स। एंड इन दिस लेक्चर कम ट्यूटोरियल और डेमॉन्स्ट्रेशन, वी आर गोइंग टू फोकस ऑन द हार्डवेयर प्रोग्रामिंग ऑफ PKTNF4550 यूजिंग MPLAB XIDE। We are going to simulate the programs also as we did in the theory portion of our course, but in addition what we are going to do is we are going to transfer that code physically to the actual hardware trainer board, burn it and test the codes and see the physical output waveforms on oscilloscope and on the LEDs and verify that whether the codes that were running in the simulation also work on our hardware as well or not. So I am going to take you through the process step by step of how to generate the hex file for transferring it physically to the hardware and which tools you are going to use, which programmers you are going to select and which software you are going to use to transfer that hex file and burn it on your microcontroller IC. So the focus of this lecture or this demonstration video is not to develop the logic of the codes themselves, but rather we want to focus on how to transfer that code to your hardware and physically run them on the practical trainer boards. So let's start with your lab manual.
This is your lab manual for this course, for the lab portion, and these are the contents that we are going to cover in today's lecture. The lab 1 is related mostly to the basic understanding of PIC microcontroller families, and at the end of this lab we are going to write a simple assembly language program to test whether we have rightly understood all the steps and the process that is required to transfer our code to the hardware. And from lab 2, all the programming will be done in C language. We are going to cover the timers, counters, interrupts, ADC, CCP, CCP module and serial communication and the LCD. So all these labs are actually they have the same contents that we have already covered in our theory portion, and we have done extensive simulations of all of these mentioned contents. What's left is to run those programs, transfer those programs onto the hardware and see whether the programs that we wrote that were working in the simulation, they perform in a similar manner on the hardware as well, or there are some other considerations that we have to keep in mind while programming the actual hardware. So we are going to discuss these points in this video demonstration cum lecture. What I am going to do is, I have written the programs or the codes for all these labs, for all the tasks of these labs. And I'm not going to explain the logic behind those codes again. Only in a couple of codes, there are some new things that needed to be added, and that some new logics that I had to make, and that I will explain in this lecture. But apart from that, the basic codes, the basic working of these peripherals and how to write a program and how to handle these peripherals and how to write values to the control registers and configure them, all of that has been covered in your theory portion. So I am not going into the details of that part. So let's jump to the lab 1. The objective of this lab is to get familiar with PIC family of microcontrollers, its features and programming environment. All of that has been extensively covered in detail in our theory portion. The helping material uploaded in the Microsoft Teams channel and the video lectures provided for theory part of the course are very, very important. So if you have not seen those video lectures very carefully, these labs are going to be difficult for you. And if you have watched those lectures carefully and you have done your theory portions assignments, these labs are going to be a walk in the park for you. So let's jump to the activities and exercise. So this portion 1.4 has only one task related to lab 1. This task was supposed to be completed by the students in the laboratory, but unfortunately, as you are all away from the campus and you are in your homes and you don't have access to the hardware, what I am going to do is I am going to run the code for this task on the hardware. Here I have the hardware with me, and I am going to show the results of this code to you guys via video. I will record a video and I will show you what type of results you are going to see when you burn this code on the actual hardware. And we are going to match those results with the simulation results in Proteus. We are required to write a simple assembly language program to continuously flash all port LEDs one by one in a line with a 0.4 second on time for each LED. Use Proteus to simulate your results. Submit the screenshots of simulation results along with your codes as lab reports. So, what we are expected to do in this code is, we have port A of 7 bits, port B of 8 bits, port C of 6 bits, port D of 8 bits, and port E of 3 or 4 bits. So all of those LEDs we have to turn on one by one for 0.4 seconds and then move to the next. So for example, this is port A LED, this is port A0, port A1, port A2, port A3. So first this LED will be on, then this. So it will look like that our LEDs are moving from one side to another side. So let's jump to the code directly. Let me open the MPLABX IDE. Okay, so I have two projects open in my left panel. You can see that. And if you expand these menus, you can see that this randomly named project has an ASM file, source file in it, and this lecture 31 has a C file in it. And you can also see that the title of this is in bold and the title of this is not bold, it is regular. So whichever, if you open multiple projects, only one of the projects is in bold, and this indicates that which one project is the main project, the active project. The other, all other projects will be inactive or the secondary projects. So how I can switch between different projects to set them as main project or not? I can right click on the project name and I can search down this menu and see here I can see set as main project. So once I click this set as main project, you can see that now the lecture 31 is in bold and this randomly named project is not bold anymore. What we want for our first code is a C based project or an assembly based project. We need to write our code in assembly for our first lab. So let me switch back to the first project as the main project. And here we have a file added in this particular project, a source file. I have done all the configurations as explained in our theory portion, theory based lectures. So I don't need to go into the details of that. My program starts from here. And before jumping to the program for my lab 1, let me explain what does this program do that is written here. What I am doing is I am clearing port D and then I am running an infinite loop by toggling the port D. Jump to again what I am trying to do is, I am trying to generate a waveform of the highest possible frequency that can be achieved using this microcontroller. We don't have any better way or any more efficient way to generate a waveform that has a higher frequency than this waveform. Why? Because this instruction BTG consumes two instruction cycles. This go to again consumes two instruction cycles. So a total of four instruction cycles are consumed. If I replace this go to with BRA, it will consume one less instruction cycle. So it will consume total three instruction cycles. This means that we can generate a waveform in which the port will remain in one state for a minimum of at least three instruction cycles. We can generate a waveform with a higher delay, but we cannot generate a delay of less than three instruction cycles using this microcontroller. We can control the accuracy. Do not confuse the minimum delay with the resolution. The resolution is the step that we can give the accuracy that we can achieve in generating the delay. For example, I can generate a 3 instruction cycle delay or a 3 microsecond delay. I can generate a 4 microsecond delay. I can generate a 5 microsecond delay with steps of 1 microsecond or 1 instruction cycle each. But I cannot generate a single 1 microsecond delay using this microcontroller. So that you have to keep in mind. And that was the issue that we were facing while we were trying to write a code to generate a 100 kHz waveform using CCP module. Because as I said, that this is the most efficient method to generate a high frequency waveform. And no other method can generate even a waveform with this much small delay. So if we are going to use CCP or timers, the minimum possible delay will be even higher. It may go up to 7, 8 or 10 microseconds or 10 instruction cycles. So let's first build this code and let's first try to run this code and simulate this code in Proteus and see what is the result, what we are getting. So I am just going to build this code right now. I am not going to burn this code. Once this build is successful, let me open the Proteus. Let me select the appropriate hex file that I want to run on this simulation. So we can see here that I have already selected the desired hex file that was generated by this randomly named project. So I'll just click OK. Our waveform is supposed to be generated at RD0. So let's disconnect both of them to avoid confusion. And now just run this code. And you can see here that a waveform is being produced. You can see at this point and at this point, the time between these two is 3 microseconds. 3 microseconds written here. You cannot read that. But you can see that the scale is set to 1 microsecond. And there are 3 boxes being covered by one state of this waveform. 1, 2, 3 boxes. So a minimum delay of 3 microseconds has been generated. Now, as I said, that if I change this branch command to go to, that takes one more instruction cycle, our delay should change from 3 microseconds to 4 microseconds. So let's run this and let's see. You can clearly see here that now the 3 boxes have been changed to 4 boxes, 1, 2, 3, 4 with the same scale of 1 microsecond. So now, both of our instructions are taking 2 microseconds to execute. This is the minimum delay that we could generate using PIC microcontroller with 4 MHz. And in instruction cycle, for any frequency, we can get a minimum delay of 3 instruction cycles. Whatever frequency our microcontroller is being operated on. And now let's move to the code for lab 1. So let me copy and paste this code in MPLAB XIDE. Here you can see that R1, R2 and R3 are equated to RAM locations 1, 2 and 3. And I have used these registers to generate a delay, as you can see here. So the delay subroutine is same, the one we developed previously in our first lecture. This is the same subroutine, I have just copied it and pasted it here. In the rest of the program, there is no logic or an algorithm that you have to develop. You just have to send alternate values one by one to the port. So, first off, I am clearing all the tri-state buffers associated with all the ports to make all ports, each and every pin of all the ports as output pins. Then I am clearing the actual value of the ports to display 0 or send 0 on all the pins of the microcontroller. And then finally, I am making a loop that will keep on running infinitely. And first, I am sending a value of 0000001 to port A. Then I am giving a delay of 0.4 microseconds, and then I am just shifting this 1 to left one by one. So what you can do is you can make an algorithm for that, and you can just move this value in your port and rotate it 8 times or shift it 8 times, and that will do the job. And after shifting it 8 times, the port A, move to port B, do the same, move to port C, do the same, port D and port E, and then go to again. So keep doing that in a loop. So let's build this program and let's try to simulate it first in Proteus, and then after that we are going to burn it on the hardware itself, and we are going to see what happens when we transfer this code to our hardware. Let me zoom in and let's run this simulation. You can see here this red dot is moving from top to bottom. Here it is moving from here, port A, port B, port C, port D, and then port E, and then back to port A. So this is what we were expecting from this simulation. So our simulation is running perfectly fine. And the similar kind of behavior we are expecting with our hardware. So let's go to the hardware part now. Before transferring this program to the hardware, let me go through the steps that are required to transfer this code to the hardware. First thing, which file do we actually transfer or burn on the hardware? The answer is the hex file. What is a hex file? A hex file is a machine language code that has all ones and zeros. I wrote this code in assembly language, and the assembler assembled these instructions to their machine language code in ones and zeros, and those ones and zeros are transferred to your RAM to physically execute them. So the first thing we are going to need is the hex file to run this code on our hardware. And you can see that here in the output, we can see this line, loading port from C users blah 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 and production.hex. And if you notice here that in Proteus also, we upload the same hex file. So it is similar to burning this hex file on this virtual IC that is being simulated in the Proteus. This hex file is transferred to this virtual memory, the ROM of this virtual IC. All we have to do is to somehow physically transfer that hex file to our actual hardware IC. And how to do that? There are many different ways. It depends upon which tool you are using, which trainer board you are using, what kind of programmer do you have, and so on. So, for this particular lab, for this first portion, I am going to discuss three different methods that we can use to transfer our code to the hardware.
Okay, so first of all, let's start with the board that we have in our lab for the student experimentation. This is the EasyPeak V8 board, EasyPeak V8, and in this board, we are using this here, this PKTNF 4550 microcontroller IC. We have an LCD, 16x2 LCD, and here in this portion, you can see many push buttons and LEDs. These white dots on top of these rectangles are the LEDs, and these rectangles are the push buttons. So this A, B, C, D and E, these are the ports A through port E. This is the power on off button and the reset button, and here we connect the USB cable. What's different in this board is that we cannot program it directly using the MPLAB X IDE. IDE means the Integrated Development Environment, and it supports a number of different variety of programmers. But the programmer in this particular case, for this board, it has a built-in programmer, and that programmer is CodeGrip. So, to program a microcontroller using this board, using the built-in programmer of this trainer board, we have to install a third-party software called CodeGrip Studio. Using the CodeGrip Studio, we can select the hex file that is generated by this MPLABX IDE, and we can simply transfer that file to our microcontroller IC that is shown here. So let me open the CodeGrip Studio. I have installed it in my PC. So here you can see that we have selected the PKTNF 4550. From where we can select this device by going to this device part on the top left, going to the options, then selecting the vendor. Our vendor is Microchip. So select Microchip and then simply type your microcontroller IC name here. If you can see, I am going to type PKTNF4550 and I will simply select this IC from the drop down menu. The speed is 4 MHz for the programming. So this is okay. And then we can go to the programming option. But we can see here on the bottom right corner that this USB symbol here is gray. Gray symbol means that no device is currently connected to this computer. If a device was connected to this computer, this symbol would have turned yellow. And I am going to connect a device right now through a USB port to my computer. I have connected the USB cable and now I will just simply turn on the device. And you can see that as soon as I turn on this device, the LCD lights up and this gray symbol turns yellow. Now, which program do I want to upload on this board right now is the program generated by this particular project, this code, and its hex file is located in C, users, memos, and MPLAB projects. So let's go to the CodeGrip Studio. Let's go to the source, click this file icon, and go to the MPLAB projects and select our desired project. Go to the distribution folder, select the default, production, and here is your hex file. Now your desired hex file has been selected. All you have to do is, you have to simply click the right button to transfer this program to your board. Now you can see here that the write operation is done and verified. But here you cannot see anything. That's because the LCD was connected and it is there is a conflict in the port assignment. So what I am going to do is, I am going to remove this LCD. Now you can see that I have removed this LCD, and you can see that here in the video a red light is quickly passing through from left side from right side to the left side on all the ports. The issue is that the speed of this is much higher than what we expected and than what we simulated. And what's the reason behind that? Anybody guesses? Okay, on which value the speed depends? The speed of these LEDs depends on the main crystal frequency, right? Now you can argue that the speed here, if you see in the Code Deep Studio, the speed is selected as 4 MHz. So this isn't, shouldn't it be operating at 4 MHz? No. This 4 MHz is not the operating speed of the microcontroller. This is the operating speed of the programmer. The programmer itself has a microcontroller inside there. And that microcontroller is now being operated at 4 MHz. How can a programmer define that at what frequency our microcontroller will work? We can only select between different modes. We can select between different modes of oscillators, different sources of oscillators. We can select between high speed oscillator, external oscillator, internal oscillator, clock, etc. And let's see which clock source we have currently selected in our code, in the configuration bits. You can see here, F oscillator is HS, that is high speed oscillator. And what does a high speed oscillator mean? A high speed oscillator means that whatever crystal is connected to this microcontroller will act as the clock source, the high speed clock source for this microcontroller. And here you can see this component right here, this is the crystal. I cannot zoom in enough on this crystal, but take my word for that this crystal is an 8 MHz crystal. And this microcontroller is currently running at 8 MHz crystal frequency. So, the delay is reduced to 0.2 seconds as expected. So, this means that our code is working perfectly fine. Now, if you want to change your delay, if you want to change your delay or if you want to double your delay, you can do that. Let's make it 20 and recompile the code. And now you will notice something here. Now the source from the code grid suit has vanished because the source was modified by the MPLABX. The source was the production hex file. And that hex file has been updated. So, the Code Grip Studio has automatically removed it from its memory to make sure that a new production hex file or the updated file is loaded. So, let's select it again, click the file icon, and now you will be automatically directed to the last folder that you used. So, just click the production hex file and write the program. Now, you can see here in the video that the speed of these lights has been reduced. I have not calculated this delay to be 0.4 seconds or 0.2 seconds. I have left this exercise for you. The students are required to generate an accurate 0.4 seconds delay. I just wanted to test my program and the program logic, and it seems like it is working perfectly fine. So, this is the
first hardware and first method by which we can transfer our code or burn our code onto our physical hardware microcontroller. Let's move to the second method now. Okay, so in the second method, we are using a different board with a different programming tool built in that board for programming that microcontroller for transferring the code to the microcontroller. This board is an older model of the trainer boards that we were previously using in our lab. And here in this portion, the circuitry you can see has another microcontroller. And this circuitry is for the programmer. That programmer is known as PIC-KIT-2. PIC-KIT-2 is not a third party programmer, but it is one of the official programmers, though very old, but they were provided by the Microchip itself and they were developed by the Microchip, and the PIC-KIT-2 was made open source. So anyone could build a PIC-KIT-2 based programmer at their home by burning a microcontroller with their source code and building this simple circuit and using it as a programmer. Obviously, to burn that source code for the first time for the programmer would require another programmer, but that would be required only for the first time, and for the rest of the time you can use this circuit as the programmer to program or transfer the code to the main microcontroller IC. And as this tool is provided by the Microchip itself, this tool is supported by the MPLABX IDE. So we don't have to go to any third party software, and we can simply program this microcontroller by remaining inside this integrated development environment. That's why it is called an integrated development environment, where you can write your code, you can compile it, you can simulate it, you can debug it, and you can burn it onto your desired microcontroller. So let's change this delay again to know whether our program has been uploaded successfully or not, and let's see which steps are required to use the PIC-KIT-2 to transfer the code to the actual microcontroller. To use the PIC-KIT-2 as your programming tool, what you have to do is you have to select it in your project options. If you have made your project already and you have ignored the tool selection portion, as I told in the theory based lectures, because you are not burning that code on the hardware itself at that time, it's okay, you can still change the properties right now. So just go to the project, right click it, and move to the end of the list that says properties. Go to the properties, and then here you can see the hardware tools in the default configuration. This page will open automatically, and here you can see your device is 4550 and your hardware tool. Right now, this SNOIHOSS has been selected. This is the serial number of this PIC-KIT-2. If I remove my board right now, if I disconnect my board, this ID will disappear. Only these two yellow dots and PIC-KIT-2 will remain. Now that I have actually connected a device, the device ID is being shown, the connected device ID, under the particular option, the suitable option. I have not connected any ICD3 or ICD2 or PIC-KIT-4 or PIC-KIT-3. So you can see no device ID is being shown in all of these options. Only a device ID is being shown under the PIC-KIT-2 menu. And you can find this PIC-KIT-2 in the alternate tools. So just select this device ID, select the appropriate compiler tool chain that is already selected, and push apply. And now your hardware tool has been selected. Click OK. Return to the main program. Now, previously, what we were doing was we were just cleaning and building the main project. Now, what we want to do is we want to burn it onto the hardware also. And for that, just move to the next icon that says make and program device main project. This green arrow pointing downwards. Once you press this arrow, you can see here in the output that it is again cleaning, building and loading the program, and you can see programming completed, running target, and you can see here the speed of LEDs is increased. Now this doesn't seem to be running in the desired pattern because the location of LEDs for different ports is different on this particular board. For example, these top left 8 LEDs belong to port A, then there is port E, then there is port C, then port D, and here this is port B, and that is from bottom to top. So it all depends upon the location of those LEDs on the board. Otherwise our program is running fine. Port A, B, C, D and E here. Now see, so we are successfully transferring our code directly using the MPLABX IDE onto our board that has a built-in PicKit 2 programmer on that board. So this is the second method. The last method and the third method is using PicKit 3, not PicKit 2. PicKit 2 is the oldest version of the mass-produced programmers offered by Microchip. PicKit 3 is later version, PicKit 4 is the latest version. So I have a PicKit 3 with me, and I am going to use the PicKit 3 with my custom built board to program that board, that the IC on that board using my PicKit 3 programmer. And again, as PicKit 3 is built by Microchip itself and that is not a third party, so we don't have to go outside this MPLAB IDE. What we can do is we can just right click, go to properties, and we can select the PicKit 3 instead of PicKit 2. Once I connect that, and we will be getting an ID under PicKit 3. So let me take my board, let me connect that, and I'll show you how that works. Alright then, here is our PicKit 3. This red board, this red device, that is our programmer, that is PicKit 3. It has a connection that is going from this programmer to this board, and this board is a custom built board with PicKit NF 4550 currently installed in this socket. So I am going to program this board using the PicKit 3, and as I have connected the PicKit 3 with my computer, if you right click on the project again, go to the properties and see the available options. Now you can see that there is no device ID under PicKit 2, but a device ID has appeared under PicKit 3. So let's select that and let's click OK. After clicking OK, let me increase this delay, because in this board, in this custom board, I have connected a 20 MHz oscillator right here you can see. Again, to program this device using the PicKit 3 that we have already selected using the tools, I will again click this green arrow pointing downwards. So this downwards pointing arrow means download your program, the hex file, into your microcontroller. Just click it, and seeing the output, you can see here it has switched to PicKit 3. It is confirming the firmware. It has confirmed that it is for PicKit family. It is configuring the memory, and the programming has been completed. And you can see that these LEDs are now slower than the previous ones. Let's increase the speed again to check once again whether our programmer is working fine or not. So now let's keep looking at this video portion and keep looking at the frequency of these LEDs. See, it has increased. The speed of the LEDs has been increased. So these are the three methods that you can use very conveniently to program your device and to physically burn your code into your microcontroller. There is a fourth option also. Unfortunately, I cannot demonstrate that fourth option right now. But let me tell you about that. That if you simply have any one of these three programmers with you, you can burn a bootloader on your main IC. Now, what does a bootloader do? A bootloader is a permanent program inside your microcontroller memory from where your device boots, from where your device starts. And that program remains inside your microcontroller. So, you won't need any other kind of programmer to program your IC again. For example, I can burn a bootloader on this device using this programmer, and then for the rest of the life of this microcontroller, I won't need this programmer, this separate programmer. And I can use that bootloader to directly program this IC. But then the question is, how will this IC connect to the computer? Right now it is connected to the computer using this programmer. In that case, if we don't have any programmer, how will our device connect to the computer? We have two options. This microcontroller IC, the 18F4550, has a built-in USB port. So we can use that built-in USB port to connect it to the computer directly. And it also has a serial port that we already programmed. And we can use that serial port to connect that that IC to the computer. So you can make a board of your own sitting at your home. You can do all these experiments at your home without needing any programmer, but for the second time. Unfortunately, for the first time, you need a programmer to burn the bootloader. So these are the options using which you can physically program your microcontroller. And this was the main purpose of our lab 1, to explore the options and to get familiar with the programming environment and programming options and the tools available to us that we can use to actually run the program on our hardware. And from the second lab onwards, I am only going to use the EasyPIC V8 board, and I'm going to show the actual working hardware in the video. Okay, so let's move on to our second lab. The second lab is based on timers and counters programming in PKTN-F4550. We already know that there are four timers in PKTN. Timer 0, timer 1 and timer 3 are all 16-bit timers, while timer 2 is an 8-bit timer with a dedicated period register. Skipping the theory part and the portion taken from the data sheet that we have already discussed in our theory-based lectures, let's jump to the activities and exercise that we needed to perform in this lab. So there are two tasks that we needed to perform to test the codes that we wrote for this lab. In the first activity, we are required to write a program to create a delay of 1 second using timer 1 and flash the LEDs of code D with a 1 second delay. So let me open the code for lab 2 question 1. Let me copy that code to my source file. I have closed the second project as it was related to the assembly language programming. So now I have only lecture 31, that is a C-based project, open with me, and I have to right-click it and set it as the main project. If you can see here, I have used timer 0 to create that 1 second delay, but we were asked to use timer 1 to create that delay. So all you have to do is to use the same code, the same logic, but replace the timer 0 with timer 1 and generate this 1 second delay. So how did I generate that 1 second delay using timer 0? Let's go to the data sheet and find out. In the data sheet, This is the timer 0 module, and in the timer 0 we can select between any of these 8 prescalers. We know that to generate a 1 second delay, 1 second means 1000 microseconds. And using a 4 MHz crystal oscillator as the main clock source, each instruction cycle is 1 microsecond. So we need 1000 instruction cycles to be executed to generate a delay of 1 second. But using timer 0 or timer 1, we can only count up to a maximum value of 65536 to raise to the power 16. So in this case, we need to use a prescaler. So I used a prescaler of 16, divided by 16, and we are left with a value of 62500. I subtracted this value from 65536, and the result 3036 is to be loaded into the preloaded into the timer register, as you can see here, 3036. This key has been cleared to make port D as an output. The T0 CON register has been configured to select a prescaler of 16. Last two bits are 1, and if you can see here, the last two bits are 1. A 1:16 prescaler is selected, and the port D is loaded with a value of 0x55 hexadecimal value. And in while one loop, we are continuously complementing the port D with a delay of 1 second. So, let's build this program. The build is successful, the hex file has been created, and now we have to simulate it in Proteus. So, let me select the desired hex file in Proteus, and here when I simulate it, you can see that the port D is being complemented after a delay of 1 second. Now, let's burn this code on our hardware. This is our trainer board and this is our programming suite. Let me select the desired hex file and turn on the board. The board is now on and you can see that the previous code is right now running on the board. Once I click this write button, the new code will be loaded into the microcontroller and it will start running. So you can see here that the port D is blinking alternatively, but the delay is not 1 second, and I have told you the reason for that, that we are using 8 MHz crystal oscillator in this board. So our code is working perfectly fine as expected. Now let's move to the second task of lab 2. In the second task, we are required to write a program to use timer 0 as a counter and continuously display the count on port B. To use the timer in counter mode, all we have to do is we have to select the clock source from the external pin, the transition on T0 CKL pin. So we had to set the bit 5 of T0 CON register. Let's open the code. And here you can see that bit number 0, 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5 is set. Why bit number 6 is set? Let's see here. Bit number 6 says whether the timer is configured as an 8-bit timer or a 16-bit timer. So I have configured this timer 0 as an 8-bit timer because we are displaying the count only on an 8-bit port. So the count will not go and should not go more than 255. Also, the timer 0 prescaler had to be disabled. The bit number 3 had to be set. If this prescaler bit is set to 0, an automatic prescaler of 2 is assigned to timer 2. So every 2 transitions will result in 1 count. But we want 1 count up for every 1 transition. So we have disabled the prescaler, as you can see here in the code. And again, we have set the port D as an output, cleared it, loaded the timer with a value of 0 and started the timer in counter mode. And in while 1, we are just sending the value of timer 0 low register to port D. Let's build this program. The build is successful. Now let's open Proteus and let's connect a push button to the T0 CKL.
If you can see here, RF4 is T0CKL. So let me connect the push button here and let me run the code. You can see that there is 0 on port D, and if I press the button, it should increment. You can see here, there is an increment of 1. If I keep pressing it, it will keep incrementing. So our code is running perfectly fine in this simulation. Let's stop the simulation and let's try to burn the code on our hardware. And let's see if it works fine there also. The hex file has been generated. All we have to do is we have to open the CodeGrip Studio, select the hex file again, and write it to the microcontroller. And now the code is running. And you cannot see anything on the port because the port D here is the port D, and the port D is all zeros right now. The port will increment as soon as there is a transition on T0CKL pin, that is RF4. So I have to connect a push button to RF4, and you can see here there are many dip switches, and these dip switches let us choose whether we want to connect our dip switch to the port or an LED to the port, and whether we want to make the dip switch as or the push button as an active high or as an active low. So this is the button press level, and let me enable it for port C. I have made it to pull it down when the button is pressed. So when the button is pressed, the pins on port C or the pins on port A will be pulled down. Let me enable it for port A. And let me enable the pull up pull down resistors as shown here. These dip switches let us choose whether we want to pull up or pull down a particular port. So RF4 should be pulled up. Now, as soon as I press this button, the count will keep incrementing. You can see here that this button, I pressed it again. You can see the LED go off here, and the count is being incremented on port D. You can see it here. I keep pressing it, the count doesn't go up, the LED is off, and when I release it, there is one count up. So our program is working perfectly fine on the hardware side also. So this means that we have successfully completed both the tasks of lab 2. And now we can move on to the lab 3. Lab 3 is related to the interrupts programming. Any kinds of interrupts. We can use external interrupts, timer interrupts, or any other peripheral interrupt. We already know that what are the interrupt sources available for PKT microcontroller, and we have done the simulations for that. This is the format for the interrupt ISR that we have to use. And let's go to the activities and exercise. There is a single activity that we need to perform. We are required to write a program to count the number of people entering and leaving a room using two infrared sensors at the gate or at the door. Use this data to turn on the lights of the room if anyone is inside, and turn the lights off when the room is empty. Also, light an LED indicating that the room is now full when 20 people are inside. Use timer, counter, interrupts and or external interrupts to perform this task. So let me explain what exactly we are required to do here. Let's assume this is your door, the cross section. Here is one sensor and here is another sensor. This is the room and this is the outside of the room. A person entering the room will cross this sensor first and this sensor second. And the person leaving the room will cross this sensor first and this sensor second. And as I said, that there are two sensors installed at the entrance of the room. So these are those two sensors. Now we can
see whether the person is leaving or entering the room by checking the sequence in which these two sensors give us a pulse. These two sensors, if crossed, give a pulse of a high to low. And when the person has paused, they become high again. So we can make a check whether sensor 2 was crossed first or whether sensor 1 was crossed first. And we can determine whether a person has entered the room or whether a person has left the room. Then we need to have a counter that keeps the track of people that are entering or leaving the room. And if that counter is 0, all the lights inside the room should be off. So to turn off the lights inside the room, we will emulate that using a simple LED by turning it on or off. And then if the count reaches 20, the full signal, there is a signboard on the entrance of the room, on the door, and it tells the people outside that now there are 20 people inside the room and no one else can enter. So we will have another LED for that to indicate whether the room is full or not. So what we are going to do is, we are going to use two external interrupts for this purpose. And those two sensors, they are connected to those two external interrupt pins. If interrupt 0 comes, the person has entered the room and this sensor gave a pulse first and this sensor gave a pulse second. And if a person left the room, this sensor gave a pulse first and interrupt 1 came. I have made a simple logic assuming that if an interrupt comes by a person crossing any of these sensors, it should always first check whether the interrupt was because of this sensor or not. So whether the person entered the room or not. So let's assume a person starts from here and starts walking inside the room. As soon as he crosses this sensor, the interrupt 0, the interrupt will come and the program will jump to the ISR. Inside the ISR, in the first line I am checking if the interrupt was if the interrupt has occurred because of interrupt 0. So I am assuming that by this point the person has not crossed this second sensor, because the person will take around 1 millisecond to reach from this sensor to this sensor, but the program will take around 1 or maybe 10 microseconds to execute this instruction. So the program is faster. So if the person has only crossed this sensor, we don't need to check the second one. The person will obviously cross the second sensor as well after crossing the first sensor, but we already know that this sensor was the first he crossed. So we do not need to check the second sensor at all. So that's why I have used an else if condition, even though I am using two separate interrupts in this program. Otherwise, normally what we do is, if we are using more than one interrupts, we use only if conditions, no else if condition. They are mutually independent. But in this case, we are using two interrupts, but we are using it as mutually dependent interrupts. Now let's assume the person has crossed the first sensor. I have incremented the count and it will not check the second condition. So even if the interrupt was there, even if the person had crossed this second sensor, and it was supposed to generate an interrupt, the interrupt flag was 1, but I am not checking the flag. Without even checking the flag, I am clearing both the flags to 0. So even if the interrupt came, I am ignoring it without doing anything. Now let's assume a person is walking outside the room, from inside to outside. Sensor 2 will be crossed first. As soon as the sensor 2 is crossed, interrupt 1 will occur. And as soon as interrupt 1 will occur, it will go to the ISR. It will come here, it will check if interrupt 0 occurred or not.
Now in this case, again, I am assuming that the person has not yet reached the second sensor, the sensor at the outside, the INT0 sensor. It has not reached that. So it will check the if condition and it won't be true. And only in that condition, it will check the else if condition, int 1. And now that was true. And while checking this condition and while decrementing the count, maybe now the person has crossed this sensor also, the right one. And if I don't clear the flag, it will return to the ISR. So again, regardless of whether the sensor was crossed or not, and we already know that it was crossed, I am again clearing both the flags. So I clear both the flags and return. So I am keeping a track of the count as well. Incrementing it when the person enters, decrementing it when the person leaves, and then returning from the ISR. So what I am doing inside my main loop, what I am doing after returning from the ISR, this. I have made port B as an input port, port D as an output port. To port D, our lights and our full sign is connected. To port B, our two sensors are connected that are inputs. I have enabled the interrupt 0 and interrupt 1, and then in the while 1, I am continuously checking if the count was greater than 0, RD0 is equal to 1, turn on lights. This means turn on room lights, else if the count was not greater than 0, it was 0. So else turn off room lights. Then the second if condition, if the count is equal to 0, is equal to 20, turn on room full sign. Else, if the count was not equal to 20, obviously it was less than 20, turn off room full sign. And you noticed here that I said obviously it was less than 20. If it is not equal to 20, it can be even more than 20. But the room full sign indicates that there is no more space in the room, so obviously no one will enter the room. So let's try to compile this code. The build is successful, and now let's try to simulate this code. Okay, so I have connected two switches, two push buttons to replace the sensors in our system. This top button is connected to RB0, and this bottom button is connected to RB1. And the port D should display the number of people present inside the room. So let's simulate this code. Currently you can see that port D is displaying 0. So this means that no one is inside the room. The lights are off and the full sign is off. As soon as someone enters the room, the lights turns on. But the count is not being displayed here. Only RD0 and RD1 represent the room lights and the full sign. So now the lights are on. I have pressed it twice. So let me press it 20 times. 20. As soon as I pressed it the 20th time, RD1, the full sign is now on. So now no one can enter the room. So let's start removing the people one by one. Whenever I press it once, the people will become 19 and this RD1 will immediately go off. And you can see here. And when I press it 19 more times, the RD0 will also turn off, turning off the room lights, as the number of people inside the room will become 0. You can see that the lights have turned off. So our simulation is running perfectly fine. Let's move on to the board again. Now our sensors are connected to port B. So I am resetting the positions for port A. And I am enabling the button press for port B. And I am also pulling up the RB0 and RB1. And after making the initial settings of the board, doing the initial settings of the board, let me upload the program. So the write operation is finished. Okay. So here you can see that RB0 and RB1 are both inactive and there is 0 on port D. So if I press RB0 just once, RD0 should turn on. So let me press it once and you can see that RD0 is now on. Let me go to 20 counts
and see whether RD1 turns on or not after 20 counts. So I'll keep pressing it until RD1 turns on. The count is being incremented and people are entering the room. And you can see that I have definitely crossed a count of 20, but RD1 has not turned on. It wasn't what we were expecting. So what's wrong? There is nothing wrong with the code. Let me tell you that when we are using these push buttons, there is a noise. Once we press the push button, let me show you here, the waveform that is being generated is not a perfect 90 degree. Rather, the waveform changes like this. So these edges, all of them are counted as one count. So even if I press the button once, this noise will make it register 4 to 5 counts. So it is quite possible that I pressed this button once when I was on 19 count and it recorded 2 to 3 counts. So it went up from 19 to 23. But if we see in our program, our condition is that the RD1 will turn on only if the count is equal to 20. So let me change this condition. If the count is greater than or equal to 20, and let's see what happens then. RD1 will turn on, and even if we are getting multiple counts by pressing the button once, we will be able to see whether our code is working or not, or is there something wrong with our code. So let's write this code and let's see again. So here I will keep counting this time. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20. It's perfect. This time there was no noise. After 20 counts, exact 20 counts, RD1 turned on. And if I start counting down, RD1 turns off. So I counted 1 down. Let me count again. But count down this time. So the people are leaving. 18, 17, 16, 15, 14, 13, 12, 11, 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. So what happened this time? Why it wasn't working last time? Because last time I was using this screwdriver to press the button. And that resulted in some jittering. So this time I use my finger to stably press the button and avoid the noise as much as possible. So our code for this lab 3 is working perfectly fine as expected on both software and hardware, and we can safely move on to our lab 4. And lab 4 is related to the ADC programming that we have already covered again in our theory course. So in our lab 4, there is just one task. We have to use the ADC interrupt to continuously send the upper 8 bits of digital data from channel 0 to port B, channel 1 to port C, and channel 2 to port D. So in this case, we are going to use 3 channels of ADC at a time, and the data of all those 3 channels will be sent continuously to port B, port C, and port D. Let me tell you one thing here, that using 3 channels at a time doesn't mean that they are running in parallel. They run one by one. So first I will select channel 0, start conversion, ADC conversion, convert that analog data to digital data, and then after saving that data, I will switch to channel 2, read data from there, convert it to digital, save it, and then switch to channel 3, and then switch back to channel 0, and so on. So we do it one by one.
So this is the code for the lab 4 task. In the main loop, we are making port B, C and D. Those are our display ports as the output ports, and we are clearing all the ports initially. Then we are making the TRISC A0, TRISC A1 and TRISC A2 as inputs. These three are our analog input channels. Then we are configuring the ADCON 0, 1 and 2 registers. So let me open the data sheet and let me tell you what kind of configuration you want to do in this case. So let's go to the ADC module. In ADCON 0, we can select the between different channels using the CHS3, CHS2, CHS1 and CHS0 bits. So we are going to start from channel 0, so all these pins will be 0 and the board on will be 0 and the AD on will be 1. So it should have 0000001. Then in ADCON 1 register, we can select how many pins we want to configure as analog inputs and how many pins we want to configure as digital inputs. We want to use only 3 channels, AN0, 1 and 2. So we can see from this table AN0, 1 and 2, and it tells us that we have to write 1100 in the PCFG3 to PCFG0. And that's what we have done here in our code, 1100. And then to the ADCON 2 register, we have selected the 4 TAD and F oscillator by 32 or F oscillator by 8 for acquisition time and conversion time. And we are using the left justified option in which the upper 8 bits are in one register and lower 8 bits are in the separate register, and we are going to ignore the lower 2 bits. So let's see what else we have done in this program. We have enabled the ADC interrupt, we have started the conversion, and we are waiting for the interrupt to occur. So once the conversion is finished from channel 0, the interrupt comes and it goes to the ISR, and inside the ISR we are doing everything. So we are seeing that if CHS0 and CHS1, those are channel select bits, if they were 0, we were at channel 0. And if we were at channel 0, we want to display that data of channel 0 to port B. So we send the ADRESH to the port B. And at the same time, we switch from channel 0 to channel 1. All the else if are ignored, and I clear the interrupt flag, I start the conversion again and I leave. So the next time when the interrupt comes, the CHS0 was 0 but CHS1 was 1. So this if condition is not true, this else if condition is not true. CHS0 is 1 and CHS1 is 0. So when the channel 2 was selected, I wanted to display the data on port C. So I have sent the data of ADC to port C, switched the channel to channel 3 and left, and so on so forth. So let's try to build this code. The build is successful. Let's open Proteus for simulation. So this is channel 0, this is channel 1 and this is channel 2. I am going to send 1 volts to channel 0. I am going to send 2 volts to channel 1 and I am going to send 3 volts to channel 2. And let's simulate this program. And you can see that 3 different data are currently appeared on the port B, C and D. So let's check if this data is correct or not. At port B, we are getting 0011, 0011. That is 51 in decimal. That is 1/5 of 256, 255. And we are giving 1 volt to channel 0. That is 1/5 of the 5 volts, that is the maximum limit by default. We have not changed the reference value. So the reference is from 0 to 5 volts. So it can go up to maximum 5 volts, and 1 volt is 1/5 of that. So 51 is 1/5 of 255. Our data is correct. Let's move to channel C. In channel C, we are getting 0110
And now we have a missing RC3, so I will just write 0 instead of that. And then we have 0110. That is 102 in decimal. 102 is double of 51. 2 volts is double of 1 volts. So at channel 1, we are providing 2 volts. That is perfectly fine. So what we are expecting at channel 2 then, the third channel, on port D, we are expecting a decimal value of 153. So a binary value of 1001 1001, and you can see here 1001 1001. So our code is simulating perfectly fine as per our expectations. What's left is to simulate this code, to burn this code on actual hardware and see if it is working as good there or not. Alright, so let's burn this code on our hardware and let's see if it is working fine or not. So I have programmed the hardware and you can see that port B, port C and port D, all of the pins are randomly on. 2 LEDs are on and the rest of the LEDs are off. As I have not connected any analog input to the source, to the RA0, RA1 and RA2, they are showing some random value. And you can see an interesting phenomena here, that as I bring my finger near these RA1 and RA0 and RA2 pins, the number of LEDs that are on start increasing for all the three ports. If I go further near, the fourth LED is on, and if I touch the pins, many of the LEDs are on. So my body is acting as an antenna and it is catching some noise from the environment. So let me see if I connect an antenna of simple wire to one of these channels, the number of LEDs that are on has increased significantly, because this antenna is now catching the noise very significantly as compared to these headers. Now to see whether my program is running fine or not, what I can do is, I have connected this pin to the RA2 channel and the data is being displayed on port D. So if I ground this pin, the port D should turn off. You can see that the port D has turned off completely, while there are still some LEDs that are on for port B and port C. And if I bring my finger again near to the port RA0 and RA1 and I touch them, port B and C are changing, but now the channel 2, RA2 is not floating. So there is still no output on port D because it is getting a complete zero. So this means that our ADC is working perfectly fine and our channels are working perfectly fine. Same experiment can be repeated with channel 1. So now our port C will remain off, and if I bring my finger near, port B and port D will display random values. And if I switch it to channel A, the port B should remain off and the rest of the channels should show, the port C and port D should show random values here. So my ADC, all the three channels, they are working perfectly fine as expected. Okay, so let's go to the lab number 5, that is related to the capture compare PWM module. Skipping the theory part, let's go straight to the activities and exercise. There are 3 tasks related to this lab. In the first task, we are required to use ADC interrupt and CCP1 and CCP2 modules to design a variable PWM duty cycle system that captures the ADC value from channel 0 and channel 1 and use them as the duty cycle of PWM 1 and PWM 2 respectively. So this code is very, very similar to the one we wrote in our lecture. We used only one ADC channel and used the ADC value as the duty cycle of both the PWMs. In this case, we are going to add another ADC channel. We are going to use 2 ADC channels and use those two values as the duty cycles of the two PWMs that we are going to generate. So we are going to use both CCP1 and CCP2 in PWM mode. The time period of both these PWMs will be same because that will be generated using the PR2 register, and there is only one PR2 register that is associated with timer 2. And the duty cycle of both these PWMs will come from channel 0 and channel 1 of the ADC. So let's look at the code that I have written for this particular task. In this code, we are using the ADC interrupt. So starting with the interrupt ISR, if the channel 0 is 1, switch the channel as we did in our previous code in the last layer, and move the data, the converted data, the digital data to the CCPR1 L register. And if the channel was 1, change the channel and move the converted digital data coming from the ADC into the CCPR2L. So now the data from channel 1 is setting the time period for CCP1 PWM, and the data from channel 2 is setting the duty cycle of the CCP2 register, CCP2 PWM. And before leaving the ISR, clear both interrupt flags of the ADC and start the conversion again. In the main loop, just regular stuff is there. We have declared port C1 and port C2 as output because there our two PWMs will be generated, and we have declared port A0 and port A1 as the inputs because these two are our analog input channels. Then we have configured both the CCP1 and CCP2 in PWM mode. This 1-1 defines the PWM mode. Then we have used the T2 CON register without any prescaler. And then we have selected the ADDCON 0, 1 and 2 register just like we did in our previous code in our previous lab. We have enabled the interrupt for the ADC. We have set the time period of the waveform using the PR2 register by setting 249. So a time period of 250 microseconds will be there. Turned on the timer, started the ADC conversion and then waited. So let's simulate this code. The build is successful. Now let's try to simulate it. And I am connecting the port A of my channel with the RC1, the CCP2, and channel B with RC2, CCP1. And I have already connected 1 volt with channel 0 and 2 volts with channel 1. So the duty cycle of these two will be different. So let's try to simulate it and let's see the two waveforms that are being produced here. And if I switch the trigger source to channel B, we can see that the CCP2 has that the CCP2 is connected to channel A and its value is coming from channel 0, and channel 0 has 1 volt connected to that. So the duty cycle is lower in this case and the duty cycle is higher in the other case. And if we see the time period, we can calculate here that there are 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5 boxes as the total time period, and currently it is at 50 microsecond scale. So the total is 15 to 5, 250 microsecond duty cycle waveform. We can connect potential states instead of these fixed values or any other sensor instead of these fixed values. But the point is, whatever value is being connected to these two channels, that is determining the separate independent duty cycle of these two PWMs being generated using the CCP1 and CCP2 modules. So let's burn this program on hardware. What's going to happen is that we should be observing two different waveforms on port C1 and port C2. So let me connect an oscilloscope with port C1 and port C2. So I am using two different channels of this oscilloscope, and let me connect the ground of these probes to the ground of this controller. We'll try to focus on the oscilloscope now. If you can see here, you can see two different waveforms. And if I bring my hand near to the analog channels, the duty cycles of these waveforms change. So you can see the two changing waveforms on your screen right now. Here, what I am doing is I am just changing the analog input value by touching the analog channels using my finger, and my body is acting as an antenna, and that noise signal catch from that antenna is acting as the analog input of my ADC channel. So these two channels are generating two different waveforms. The major portion of noise I am catching right now through my body is coming from the mains lines. The major source of noise is the electrical wiring around me. So, what I am getting now, the noise signal is a 50 Hertz sinusoidal wave. So, this is the waveform that is being produced by my finger. This is a roughly sinusoidal wave that my body is catching. I released my finger and now I put it back on the probe directly. So this signal is being captured by my body that is acting as an antenna, and that sinusoidal signal is being fed to my analog channel of my microcontroller as the analog signal. And based on this analog signal, the duty cycle of my PWM was changing. The major portion is no doubt a sinusoidal wave, but if I see the frequency spectrum and if I see the magnitude response, the data overall is random and it is not a repetitive data. So that can be used to generate random numbers as well, true random numbers. So we can use it in our projects, use an open antenna and use the noise to generate random numbers. So this was the first task of lab 5. Let's see what's required in the second task. In the second task, we are required to use the CCP1 module in capture mode, falling edge, to measure the frequency of an input waveform and display the count in microseconds on port B, lower byte, and port D, upper byte. We have already done that. I'll just simulate it again and we will see what happens. Let me paste the code here. We have enabled the CCP interrupt and we have turned on the timer. So the timer is now running in the background and the CCP will keep looking for an event to occur and will capture the value of this running timer at that particular instant. So if I apply a waveform at the input, it will actually capture the value of the timer at every falling edge of that waveform. We already did it in our theory course, we simulated it, we cleared the timer, adjusted the CCPR1L by adding 11 to it because we were getting the error, a fixed error of 11 instruction cycle, and we are displaying the lower byte of the count to port B and upper byte of the count to port D. So let's build this code. The build is successful and now let's simulate it in Proteus. And the clock frequency, let me set it to 1000 Hertz because it will give a count of 1000. So my port B and D should collectively display a count of 1000. So let's see what happens. The ports are displaying some value. Let's see if it is correct value or not. So the value we have right now is 11111101000. Let's convert it into decimal and it is a perfect 1000. So our port is simulating perfectly fine because 1000 microseconds mean 1 millisecond and 1000 Hertz frequency means a time period of 1 millisecond. So what we are going to do next is we are going to burn this program on our hardware and we'll see whether it is working as good on the hardware or not. But let me tell you one thing before moving on to the hardware. If you notice here in the Proteus, let me zoom in further. The port B, pin number 7, 6 and 5 have labels of PGD, PGC and PGM also. PG means programming data, programming clock, and this M I don't know. So these pins are not available because in the hardware we have our programmer connected. We have our programmer connected to these pins of port B, and we cannot use them. We cannot see the data that is being sent to them. So what we are going to do is we are going to assume that the data on these pins is correct if the data on the rest of the pins is correct. So let's check that.
Okay, so here you can see that our code has been burnt onto the trainer board and there is no display right now on either of port B or port D. Let me tell you that I have turned off the LEDs of port B because as the port B is associated with the programming pins, as I said earlier, connecting the LEDs to port B is causing some errors and I had to turn them off to make sure that our program runs fine. Right now, only the upper 8 bits of data will be displayed on the port D, while the lower 8 bits will not be displayed on any port as I have turned off the port B. Both the ports are currently off because there is no data input at RC2. So let me give a noise signal to RC2 and you can see the data change and you can see some value here at port D. And if I keep touching it, there is the value 100 11 010. So let's find out what this value is in decimal. This value is 39,168 in decimal, approximately 40,000. While we are ignoring the data on port B, the least significant bits are ignored. So I can safely round off that data to 40,000. Now, what does a 40,000 count mean? As we already know that this crystal here is an 8 megahertz crystal. So every count corresponds to 0.5 microseconds. And a count of 40,000 means 20,000 microseconds have passed between two edges of the input. 20,000 microseconds mean that a frequency of 50 hertz is being input to this RC2 pin. This data 100 11 010 is 40,000 or 20,000 microseconds, and this means that a frequency of 50 hertz is being fed to this RC2 that is being measured. And now if you remember, I just said that the data being fed to RC2 is the noise signal that is available all around us and my body is catching that signal. And what was the major part of that signal? The electricity mains lines. And what is the frequency of our mains waveform? 50 hertz. So that is perfectly fine. This data is perfectly being displayed. Let me test it for another signal. That signal is also a 50 hertz signal, but this time I am going to generate it using my multimeter. And I am going to give an input waveform of 50 hertz using my DMM, put at the output mode. I will connect the ground to the ground of the port and I will connect my output to the RC2 pin and let's see what happens. The same data, 10 10 0 0 10. The same data is there. So this DMM is generating an approximately 50 hertz wave. Not precisely 50 hertz, but an approximately 50 hertz wave. And that waveform is being fed to RC2. And the frequency of that waveform is being measured using the capture mode of the CCP module. And the number of counts passed between one transition and the second transition of that input wave produced by this multimeter is being shown here.
So 40,000 counts are being shown here. 40,000 counts for 8 megahertz means 20,000 microseconds or 20 milliseconds. And 20 milliseconds is the time period for a waveform of 50 hertz frequency. So the second question of our lab 5 is being perfectly simulated and is being perfectly run on the practical hardware as well. Okay, so we have already covered the first two tasks of lab 5. The third task of lab 5 requires us to use the CCP2 module in compare mode, toggle output, and generate a 20 kHz waveform at the output. We have already written a program for that in our lectures. So I'll just copy paste that program. Okay, so here is the code for question number 3 of lab 5. We are simply using the CCP2 module in compare mode. We are using the CCPR2H and CCPR2L registers combined to form a virtual period register for timer 3. We have preloaded these registers with some value, with a value of 15, and we have started the timer 3. So as soon as the timer value is equal to this value, the virtual period register of this timer, the interrupt comes. And when the interrupt comes, we have to manually reset the timer. After resetting the timer, we clear the interrupt flag and we return. So a waveform is being generated. Right now we are using 15 cycles. So this means that the interrupt should come after every 15 cycles. But we know that the clearing of this timer 3 and the clearing of this flag will also consume some cycles. And I calculated that and it happened to be equal to around 10 or 11 cycles, just like in the previous case. So we should give a value of 14 cycles for the timer plus 11 cycles. So a total of 25 cycles or 25 microseconds will be given for one state, and after 25 microseconds, the second state should come. So the total time period of this waveform will be 25 plus 25, 50 microseconds. And 50 microseconds means 20 kilohertz. So let's try to simulate this and let's see if a waveform of 20 kilohertz or a time period of 50 microseconds is being generated. So this is our Proteus and let's simulate the code. And we can see here that the waveform is remaining high for 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5 boxes, and the scale is at 5 microseconds, so each box is 5 microseconds. A total of 25 microseconds are there for the waveform to remain high, and the waveform remains low for a total of 25 microseconds. So a time period of 50 microseconds has been successfully achieved. So our program is working perfectly fine, and that error of 11 microseconds is still the same in this case also. So next, what we are going to do is we are going to burn this code on our hardware and we are going to check the output waveform on the oscilloscope to see if it is working fine there or not. Okay, so here is our hardware. Let's burn the code on the hardware. You cannot see me burning the code on the hardware, but I am going to upload the file right now. Let me turn the hardware on. It's been connected. And now I will write the code. The programming has been successfully completed. Now, you cannot see anything on any of these ports. Why? Because the waveform was supposed to be produced at port A, RC2 or RC1. But if I see here, I have turned off the LEDs of port C. So if I turn it on, you will be able to see a waveform on RC1. Now, what is the exact frequency of waveform on this RC1? Let me turn off this LED again to avoid any errors. And let me connect the oscilloscope probe to my RC1 pin. The ground of the oscilloscope is connected to the ground terminal. and the probe of the oscilloscope is connected to the RC1 pin. Let me focus on the oscilloscope right now. You can see here that some waveform is being produced. And if I zoom in, right now, I am at a scale of 5 microseconds. And if we can count, if we want to see that precisely how many microseconds are there in this waveform, we can see that there are 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5 boxes. So the total time period for this particular waveform is 25 microseconds. Half the time period of what we were getting in the simulation. This means double the frequency. And isn't it what we expected from the hardware? Because the hardware is running on a 8 MHz crystal oscillator while our simulation is running on a 4 MHz crystal. So this behavior was expected. A perfect waveform of 40 kHz is being generated using this hardware. So our code is working perfectly fine. So now we have completed 5 labs and only the last lab, the 6th lab is remaining. So let's move to the 6th lab now. Coming to the 6th lab, we are required to perform 2 tasks. First task, we are required to write a program, read a sinusoidal wave of frequency of 50 Hz at the ADC channel 0 using interrupt and continuously send the digital values to our computer using the virtual terminal. And that should be done using the serial interrupt. Also, we are required to calculate the frequency of that input sine wave and display that frequency or send it to the computer serially after a time of 5 seconds. So this is a pretty heavy task. And before starting the first task, let me read the second task also. The second task says that we are required to write a program to serially receive a data via a virtual terminal and display that data on a 16x4 LCD in real time. Both of these tasks requires to communicate the hardware board with our computer via a serial port. Starting with the first task, let's divide this task into further sub-portions. The first part of this task requires us to read a sine wave of frequency 50 Hz at ADC channel 0 using interrupt. We have already done that in our previous code. Then continuously send the digital values to computer using serial port. We have continuously sent the data of that serial wave, that sine wave received at the ADC channel to the port. Now instead of sending it to the port, we want to send it to the serial terminal. So instead of writing the address H register, copying that address H register value directly to the port D, I will copy that value to the TX reg. So that will be sent serially. Then the third part asks us to calculate the frequency of that input wave. How to calculate the frequency of that input wave? That is one question. And then send that frequency, that value of frequency to the computer serially after 5 seconds. So after we have calculated the frequency, we have to send that value to the computer after 5 seconds. So the major thing is to calculate the frequency. Sending it to the computer is not a big deal. Making a delay of 5 seconds, again, it's not a big deal. So if we successfully calculate the frequency correctly, we can send it to computer or virtual terminal serially without any issues. Let's go to the code of task number 1. This is the code for the
task 1 of lab 6. So in the main loop, I have initiated the channel 0 of port A, the analog channel 0, as an input port. I have set the values of ADC control registers, ADCON 0, 1 and 2, as we did in our previous code. I have set the value of timer 0 control register and timer 1 control register. We will be using these registers to create delays. I have preloaded timer 0 with a certain value. How did I calculate this value? I will tell you later. And I have preloaded timer 1 with a value of 0. Then I have enabled the global interrupt, timer 0 interrupt, and the ADC interrupt. Then I have enabled the serial port, transmit enable. I have set the baud rate and the and cleared the transmission flag. I have turned on the timer 0, I have turned on the timer 1, and I have started the ADC conversion and I am waiting. Now, which interrupts are active? Timer 0 interrupt and ADC interrupt, both of them are active. So while I am waiting, I can only get out of this while 1 loop if the interrupt comes. So the interrupt will come because of either of these two. So let's go to the ISR and let's see what's happening there. In the ISR, if I am here in the ISR because of the ADC interrupt, what I want to do? I want to clear the ADC interrupt flag. I want to copy the value of ADC, the digital value of that channel 0 to a variable value, and then I am doing some processing on that value. What is this processing? I will explain. And then I am sending that value step by step to our serial register, and then I am starting the ADC conversion again and I am leaving the ISR. And if I was here because of the timer 0 interrupt, what I am doing? I am copying the value of timer 1 lower register to the count, some variable count. I am doing some calculations on that to calculate the frequency, and then I am sending the frequency one by one serially to the PC, and then I am not returning from the ISR. I am being stuck here. So what will happen is my program will start executing. It will keep receiving the data of channel 0, at ADC channel 0. It will keep converting that analog data to digital data, and it will keep sending that digital data to the serial port continuously until 5 seconds are elapsed. As soon as 5 seconds are elapsed, timer interrupt will come. The frequency of the sine wave will be calculated, and that frequency will be sent to the serial port, through the serial port to the computer, and the program will stop executing. So we will have a digital data, a sampled digital data for 5 seconds of a 50 Hz sinusoidal wave, and we will use that data to actually reproduce that wave also. So now the question is, what are these calculations? What is this? And what are these calculations? So let's start it one by one. Okay, so let's assume we have a sinusoidal wave of something like this that is input to our ADC channel 0, and its value ranges from 0 volts peak to 5 volts peak. At one particular instant, let's see that at this instant, the value was around, let's say, 3 volts. That 3 volts was converted to digital value, that is 3 by 5 into 255, and that is equal to 153 in decimal number. This 153 is stored in our 8-bit register as 1s and 0s, And this is a single value. This is a single 8-bit register. Now, if I send this 153 directly to the serial port, this will be dealt as a single character, one character. And if I open the ASCII table, let me open the ASCII table for you. So here you can see a brief ASCII table. This is not the complete ASCII table. The ASCII values are starting from 30. But the actual character that is being displayed after sending a value of 30 in hexadecimal will be the character 0. This 30 in hexadecimal is 48 in decimal. Let me confirm that. The 30 in hexadecimal is equal to, if I go to the programmer mode here, in the 48 in decimal is equal to 30 in hexadecimal, right? See? So, 48, a value of 48 sent to the serial port will be automatically converted to a character of 0. A 0 character will be displayed on the serial port. And similarly, if a value of let's say 48 plus 8, 56 hexa, 56 decimal is sent to the serial port, a character 8 will be displayed on the serial port. So now coming back to the to our ADC value, we have a single value of 153. And if we send this 153 as a value to our serial port, any corresponding character, a single character will be displayed instead of this 153. And we will not even know what this character means. Maybe some steric will appear on the serial port. And looking at the steric, we will not be able to understand what was our digital value. What we want to be displayed on the serial port is 1, 5 and 3. So what we have to do to display 153 on the serial port is to send the ASCII codes of these characters independently to the serial port. The ASCII character of 1 is 49 in decimal. This is 53 in decimal and this is 51 in decimal. So how can we convert this one single value of 153 to these three values? How can we do that? We have to design some algorithm that converts this value to these ASCII character codes for each different character. So, to do that, the first thing we have to do is to separate this 1, 5 and 3. Currently, this is a single number inside a single register. We have to separate, to split this single number into three different numbers, 1, 5 and 3. And only then we can convert those single numbers into single characters that can be displayed on a serial port. Because on serial port, the data can be displayed only character by character. 1, 5, 3 are three characters, not a single character, not a single value. So we have to send three different values. So the first algorithm that I have written to convert this 1, 5, 3 into 1, 5 and 3 is this one here. What I'm doing is, I am copying the value, that ADC value, let's say 153, to a variable value, an unsigned character value that is also an 8-bit number. So I am storing it to a temporary register. Then I have defined some other temporary characters, hundreds, tens and units. So what I am going to do is, I am going to separate the hundreds figure, the tens figure and the units figure from this particular value. to separate 100's figure from this value, I have to divide 153 by 100. Dividing 153 by 100 will mean 1.53. And in digital electronics, it is always rounded off to the lower value. So, a 1 will be extracted in this way. Then, how to extract 5 and 3? So, if I write, the divide operator is this one. In C language, this slash is the divide operator. But there is another operator called the percent operator. And if I write 153%100, what it will do is, it will put the remainder as the answer into the desired variable. So 153 divided by 100 will be equal to 1, and 153%100, the percent operator, will copy the remainder as an answer. So that's exactly what I am doing here. I am first dividing this value by 100. So my 100's character is separated and it is stored in the 100 variable. And then I am adding 48 decimal to that. Because we know here that 0 is 48, 1 is 49, 2 is 50, and so on. So there is a difference of 48 in the ASCII code of these particular characters, of these particular numbers. I have added 48 to whatever value I had in hundreds. That will convert it to the desired ASCII code of that particular character, of that particular number. Then in the second step, I have used the percentage operator and I have save the remainder after dividing it by 100 into the value variable. So previously, if value had 153, after this particular operation at line number 94, the value will have a number of 53, the remainder. Then to separate the tens character from that 53, I divide it by 10, again add 48 to it, and the ASCII code of that tens character number will be stored in the variable 10. And then to get the units character, to separate the units character, I am using the percentage operator with 10, and that 3 will be stored in the units variable as a remainder. And then to convert that 3 into the ASCII code of 3, I am adding 48 to that to make it 51, and we can see here that 3 has an ASCII code of, the character 3 has an ASCII code of 51 decimal. So at this point, the 100 HUND variable has the ASCII code of the hundreds number of that particular value. The tens variable has the ASCII code of the number at the tens position, and the units variable has the ASCII code of the number at the units position. So now at this point, we have successfully converted our single ADC value into three separate values, and we have successfully converted those three values into the ASCII characters. All what's left is to send those three characters to the serial port, and that we already know how to do. How to send a value serially? Simply copy it to the TX reg and wait until the TXIF flag becomes 1. I am one by one sending the hundreds variable, the tens variable, and the units variable to the serial port. And after that, I am sending a backslash R operator to the serial port. And that backslash R is the operator for new line. So what's going to happen is, a 153 will appear without any space on the same line in my serial terminal, and then the display will move to the next line. The same thing is happening exactly in this loop. I am trying to separate the value here in timer 1 lower register into three different variables, three separate variables of hundreds, tens and units, and I am sending that data to the serial terminal one by one, and I am using multiple new line operators to distinguish that data from the digital data that we sent. So after 2-3 spaces, the data that appears will be the value of frequency that we calculated. So the last thing now remaining is how do we calculate the frequency? What is the frequency? Number of transitions in 1 second. What I did is, in this code, I used timer 0 to generate a delay of 5 seconds. And this value, this 26474, was calculated based on that. I used a prescaler of 256. Let me open the calculator. So, preloading the timer with 26474 means that it will run for 65536 minus 26474. This many times the timer will run, and a prescaler of 256 was used, so it will multiply by 256. So these will be the total counts, and if we see here, this become approximately 10 seconds. I must have used the prescaler of 128. Let me confirm that. A prescaler of 128 will require us to use a value of 110 in our T0 con register, and let's see what we have used in T0 con. 110 is used. So yes, I'm sorry, I have used a prescaler of 128, not 256. So that results roughly in a delay of 5 seconds. So we are using timer 0 to generate a delay of 5 seconds. Frequency is the number of transitions in 1 second. So in 5 seconds, the value is the value of count will be 5 times the frequency, and that's what we are doing here. We are using the timer 1 in counter mode, and we are calculating the frequency using timer 1 clock input, and that count is stored, that frequency, 5 times of that frequency is stored in the timer 1 lower register. And here, in this line, I am dividing it by 5 because I made a delay of 5 seconds. So, I calculated 5 times of the actual frequency. So, I divided it by 5 to convert it into the actual frequency. And then, I use the same algorithm here, just like I did for the ADC value. So, how can I use timer 1 in a counter mode to calculate the frequency of a sine wave that is there on the analog input? How can I do that? I did it by designing a separate circuit in my Proteus using a comparator, and let me open that. So, I used a comparator, and I connected the positive input of the comparator with the sinusoidal wave, while I connected the negative input of the comparator with the 0 volts. So, whenever this circuit is called a zero crossing detector. Let me change this value to 2. Let me change this value to half of that sine wave amplitude. So, whenever the sine wave value crosses from below the half of the peak amplitude, this will become 0, and whenever it becomes more than the half, this will become 1. So this is basically converting the sinusoidal wave into a square wave, and I am feeding that square wave to the clock input of the timer 1, T1OS or T1CKL. So if I run this code, if I simulate this code, this is my output waveform. This is my sine wave, and this is my, the blue one is my sine wave, and the yellow one is my output of the comparator. And here is my virtual terminal. And you can see that values are here. All these values have been sent serially from my microcontroller to the virtual terminal, the serial terminal, and after 2 spaces, a 050 is displayed as the final frequency of that particular wave that we calculated. I can right click and copy this data, and I will show you an interesting phenomena here. Let me open an Excel file and let me copy that data into the Excel file and plot it. Here is our data. This is for the frequency of 50 Hz. If I define the x-axis, there are 1145 samples that we have collected of that sinusoidal waveform, that 50 Hz sinusoidal waveform in those 5 seconds. So let me plot that data. And let me remind you that this is the digital data that was converted through the ADC into a digital value. Let me change the scale here. Let me display only the first 100 values. And here you can see. Here you can see that a distorted sine wave is being reproduced. The sine wave frequency was only 50 Hz, but the sampling time, the acquisition time and the conversion time resulted in distortion of the data, but we can see a roughly recreated sine wave from that digital data. You will learn this concept in signals and systems, that how much should be our minimum sampling frequency and to recreate that signal without distortion. That is called the Nyquist criteria. So you will study it in detail, but for analog to digital conversion, we need sampling of the data. And in this case, our frequency was a little bit high in case for the microcontroller to handle, to precisely convert it into a sine wave and regenerate a sine wave based on that digitized data. Now let me do an experiment and let me reduce the frequency of this sine wave. Let me reduce it to only 5 Hz and let's see what happens. Let's run this again. You can see here the data is being copied, sent serially to the virtual terminal, and see here the frequency is again calculated correctly. Now we used an input of 5 Hz and our system calculated it as 5 Hz. So let's copy this data. Let's go to the Excel file and let's paste this data here. See, this is the recreated sine wave, the 5 Hz sine wave, and look how perfect it is. The sine wave has been recreated perfectly. Why? Let's see how many samples were there in one period. In 100 samples, 1, 2, 2.5, approximately 3 cycles of this sine wave are there in 100 samples. So around 33 samples were being taken for each cycle of that sine wave in case of 50 Hz frequency. But if I revert to the older variant, in the same 100 samples, approximately 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 22 cycles were present in these 100 samples. So, for each cycle, the number of samples were only 4 to 5, less than 5. So, this means that we were trying to recreate a sine wave with only 4 samples per cycle. Let me change the format and we can see. Now you can see for one complete cycle we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 cycles. 1, 2, 3, 4, 4 cycles. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 cycles. So, the number of cycles for the number of samples for one cycle range from 4 to 6 in this case. And that are too low to recreate a sine wave. But if I go back this sine wave, you can see that for one complete cycle, we have a lot more number of samples that are used to recreate this sine wave with a lot more accuracy. So this is a very important concept that you will be using in your communications and controls
and signal processing, and the sampling time and the number of samples required to recreate a signal without any distortion is really very important. And the ADC, that is converting a sample from analog to digital value, should have a very, very high sampling rate and conversion time, very small conversion time, to effectively regenerate an analog signal after converting it into digital. So these are some of the interesting concepts that you will be studying in detail in your future courses. But for now, the code for your question number one of lab 6 is completed. So all we are left with is just one task, the task 2 of lab 6, and that task is much easier. We have already written the code of this task in our theory part, so let me copy that code here and let's try to simulate it again. We have already simulated it successfully before, so there shouldn't be any problem this time also. The code has been compiled successfully. So let's open the Proteus and let's see if it is behaving like it should. This is the Proteus simulation file. Let's run the simulation. And you can see that the LCD is on. The cursor is there, but nothing is being displayed. The terminal is open. So whatever I should write in this terminal, it should appear in real time on the LCD. So let's write EE-222. I cannot have a backspace. So let me go to the next line by entering. Okay. EE-222 laboratory. Whatever I am writing in this virtual terminal is being sent to that LCD in real time by that microcontroller. So I am not going into the details of this code because we have already discussed it in detail in our last lecture. So this is effectively exactly the same code. So what we are left to do to complete the lab demonstration and lecture is to try and run these two codes of lab 6 on hardware.
Okay, so I have my hardware setup ready to test the serial communication with the hardware. The EasyPIC V8 board we are using for this lab has a built-in USB to UART converter. Basically, the new computers do not have the serial communication port and they only have USB ports for communication. So what we needed to do was to convert the serial data on this side from the board, the data sent by this microcontroller to the USB to be received by the computer, or the data sent by the computer through the USB to be received serially by this board. The manufacturer of this board has given the USB to UART module right here on the board, and we can connect this board directly to the computer using a USB cable. And here, these DIP switches, they allow us to choose between different options to which we can connect our RX and TX pins. As we are using the default configuration, so we have selected the RC6 pin as the TX pin and the RC7 pin as the RX pin. We are going to burn the code for question number 1. On this microcontroller. In fact, I have already burnt that code on the microcontroller and I am running that, and what that code does is it is receiving a data serially on port A, channel 0 of the ADC, and it is continuously converting that data into a digital data, and it is sending that data in real time to the serial port. So what I am going to do right now is open my serial terminal on my computer, the hyper terminal, set the baud rate to 9600 and press the reset button here on the board, and whenever I press the reset button, this board sends the data for 2.5 seconds. The code we wrote was for 5 seconds, but that program was written for a clock of 4 megahertz. This microcontroller is running at 8 megahertz. So the program will run for 2.5 seconds. It will collect the data, it will keep sending it for 2.5 seconds, and after 2.5 seconds, it will calculate the frequency and it will send it to the hyperterminal at the end. Let me tell you beforehand that I have not used any comparator circuit here, and I have not connected anything to port C2 of this port, so we are not going to get the frequency result in this test. But we will be able to get the digital data of whatever waveform we will be applying on the channel 0 of our ADC. First, we are going to check it by applying a general noise by touching my finger here. And the digital data we received there, we will plot that and we will see that it should look like a distorted sine wave. Then I will apply the 50 Hz square wave from my oscilloscope to this wave, to this channel 0, and then we will try to plot it again, and it will look like a distorted square wave, but we will be able to verify the frequency by looking at the data points that we have received in our PC. So let's open the hyperterminal and let's start the data sending from this module to the computer. So here I have my serial terminal open, and you can see that we received some data previously. I will send it again. This is our code for question number 1. So let me build this code, and now let me burn it to the microcontroller again. And as soon as I press write, the microcontroller is burnt and it will start sending the data to this terminal. And I am touching my finger to the ADC channel right now before pressing the write. So now I am pressing write and it should start sending the data of that noise signal to the PC. So here you can see that the data sending has been started. And now what I am going to do is I am going to copy all this data, select all, copy, and I am going to paste it here in my Excel file. The first few values remained from the previous set, so I am deleting them, and here is our data. So this is the data, the noise data that we have received, that noise that was generated on my finger. So here we can see that this is a distorted sine wave as expected that we received through the serial channel that was converted from the ADC into a digital value. Now what I am going to do is I am going to delete this column, and I am going to send another data to my serial terminal. I cannot clear this data, so I have to delete some part of that. But I am going to use my multimeter to generate a 50 Hz square wave, and I am going to send that square wave to the input of the ADC. So now I am going to connect my voltmeter, send a 50 Hz square wave, and press reset. The data has been received. So let's select all and copy this data and paste it in our Excel file and remove the initial portion, the initial 40 to 50. Here you can see on number 43 the new data started, so I am going to delete this portion, and you can see that a much better looking waveform is there. It is not a square wave, it is a distorted square wave, but it is repetitive. So it is a periodic wave. We can see that it was not recreated exactly as it was, but the ADC is working fine and our program is also working perfectly fine. So we have successfully tested the serial communication of our microcontroller board via USB with computer. So now we can easily send and receive data from and to the microcontroller to the computer. And this, with this program, your lab tasks have ended, and I hope that this demonstration lecture help you to understand the hardware perspective of microcontroller lab and which tools you have to use and how to handle different types of signals in the practical hardware. If you have any questions related to this demonstration video, you can contact me and I'll be more than happy to answer. But what I urge you to do is to write these programs and at least try to simulate them in Proteus, because we have seen that whatever results we are getting in simulation are exactly the same results that we are getting in hardware. There are only a couple of things that need to be kept in mind while using the actual hardware, and we have discussed them in this tutorial video. So I hope this will cover up for the ability to have a hands-on experience with the hardware, and I hope that once you return to the campus, we will let you guys do the practicals using this hardware. But to wrap things up, for this semester we have to go by the simulations, and through this lecture we are very much confident now that the simulations we have been doing are giving us exactly the same results as the hardware. So it's not that bad. Wish you all the best and stay safe. Hope to see you soon. Take care. Allah Hafiz.